I want to read you just a short section from Cave Dweller. And I want to read shortly in the book after Delia falls apart. I want to chose this part because I've been traveling since the beginning of February, pretty much steadily. I've been home 3 weeks total in however many months it's been. I've lost track. And I am dressed to get on a plane when this is all over because I have to go to New York and do some television in the morning. So I am falling apart. I am ready to just go to bed, turn my face to the wall, and cry for weeks and weeks, and then get up lightened in spirit. So I want to read this section in the book where Delia does that. I have to change glasses. If anybody knows any sexy way to attach your glasses to your body, let me know. All my rings that I could attach them to are far too down low to be of use. This is San Francisco. We can say anything. All through Delia's crying season, MT used her hard-won capital. All the sympathy, understanding, all that had come her way for how her husband had cheated on her, how she had stood up for him, all that she directed at Delia, her oldest, dearest friend. Most of Cairo felt that Delia's condition when she came home, the empty grief that burned on her face, the months she spent working in Sally's cleaning crew, all that was justifiable penance for a woman who had abandoned her own girls. Opinion had not shifted enough in Cairo to forgive or understand the sin, nor enough to consider that a woman in danger might have lost those girls running from a man who would have surely strangled her if he'd caught her. No, Cairo still believed Delia a sinner, and crying season, that was a penance they understood. They liked to see it. Delia with her mouth soft and her eyes sore at the corners. MT's smartest move was to drag the unresisting Delia to Cairo Baptist Tabernacle week after week. Every Sunday, Delia sat on that hardwood pew, sallow, pale, eyes vacant, hands raw and swollen from scrubbing floors and swooshing toilets. "God surely keeps track, don't he?" Reverend Miles said to MT the first Sunday. MT linked her arm with Delia's, gave one careful acknowledging nod. She knew what she was doing. On the 10th Sunday, the 10th, Mrs. Perlman put one hand on Delia's shoulder as she pushed herself painfully up the aisle. That was an accolade. No matter arthritis, hip replacement surgery, or pain past comprehending, the truth was Marcia Perlman would never have touched the sinner without proof of repentance. It was a promise of forgiveness, if not actual forgiveness as yet. In the way of things, women screwed up like men did, but women's sins were paid for by children and women friends. The debt had a ready and simple dimension. The woman who had run off and fallen into the good life, that woman could never be forgiven. But the woman who came back, ruined, wounded, painfully sober, stubbornly enduring, that woman who suffered publicly and hard, that woman had a chance. That woman could be brought back into the circle. "Suffer a little more, girl," Marcia Perlman's hand said. "We understand this." It was fortunate that Delia was beyond understanding. Her pride would never have survived that touch. The Delia who'd sung with Mud Dog would never have stood for it. The Delia who had fought and fled Clint Windsor, she would never have endured it. Only the Delia of crying season could sit head down, and never notice when the hand of God reached toward her. Not forgiven, but understood. Not forgiven, but enjoyed. And oh, the pleasure they took in seeing her like that. No woman in the congregation would speak of it, but all of them knew, "Look at her now, Lord, look at her now." Marcia Perlman's hand on Delia's shoulder said more than all MT's whispered justification had spoken. Marcia Perlman's hand said, "Suffer a little more, woman. Suffer a little more. We'll invite you home again."
Yeah. so technologically apt, I just knocked this thing over.
Hey. So let's talk a little bit about this new book, Cave Dweller.
All right.
It's not, the first novel was semi-autobiographical, Bastard Out of Carolina.
Less so than people believe.
Well, then let's talk about that. Let's talk about how less so than people believe.
Novelists are liars. You know this. You've been talking to novelists a long time, right?
Right.
I actually think that novelists are the last people to be asked and the probably should not be trusted. It is simple fact. You make these stories up. You take some things from your own life. I steal from friends and lovers. Hell, I steal from people on television. And then you move away in the course of writing it. And you're not really to be trusted. I've always said that Bastard Out of Carolina, the first chapter, is autobiographical. It is a retelling of everything that I was ever told about how I was conceived and born. But I'm very blunt. My family is full of very fine storytellers, none of whom can be trusted. And if I don't have documentary evidence, I never believe a thing they tell me. I think that you should take that as salt for what I say. The problem is that I'm also a political activist, and I'm very matter-of-fact about being an incest survivor. Very matter-of-fact about growing up in a family in which there was tremendous physical violence, and that's the subject of Bastard Out of Carolina. So people think I'm Bone. That's why they wanted me to write Bone Goes to College. Bone gets a girlfriend, moves to California, lives right, you know. No.
It's a novel.
Yeah, it's a novel. It's a fiction. It's a lie.
But the story from Cave Dweller, does that have a basis in fact, or is that going in a different direction?
It has two bases in fact. One, when I was in my 20s, I went caving, and I was really bad at it, and I absolutely loved it. And it was very sexual and sensual for me, particularly afterward, you know, after you come out alive and look what I did. That's very true, and all of the sections on caving are written from my experience. I'm the mother of a son, so I know about mothering to a certain minor extent. And I'm a daughter, and it's a daughter's novel. And for 5 years, I lived in a small town in Sonoma County, and I got to watch really closely how small town people behave. All that is absolutely true. And the rest of it's lies.
Now, were you doing anything consciously? Did you set out to accomplish something when you started writing Quick Cave Dweller?
I set out to write a book as different from Bastard as I could make it while being in the same territory. It had to be third person, had to be multi-generational, had to be long, had to be an epic, had to prove that I wasn't a dancing dog.
And what did you learn while you were writing this book?
That all your good intentions go to hell. Start out with this notion and you have a plan, I have a rough outline, I don't outline, but I have an idea where I'm going. And it always goes differently. It always goes completely in a different direction, takes you somewhere you hadn't intended, winds up emotionally where you wanted to be, but not in the way you thought you'd get there.
But you knew where you wanted to go emotionally?
I knew where I wanted to go. I wanted to write about forgiveness. I wanted to write about the day-to-day of forgiveness and how good families are made out of bad ones. And I had some very strong notions about that. So I knew it had to be a decade long and that the beginning would be Delia going back to Cairo to try to get her girls, and that the book would end when the girls left her, basically, when they were grown enough to be strong on their own and when she had accomplished what she set out to do. But when I started out, my notion was that true redemption required enormous suffering, and one of those kids was going to die. I intended to kill one of them. I tried. It's just that it wouldn't work. It really wouldn't work. There are lots of things I'd love to write, but I can't make them happen, and if they don't happen, then you won't ever see it. I won't publish it.
So the characters just kind of took off
and they do their own thing. I didn't know Delia was going to shoot Nolan. I knew she was capable of it. I didn't know that Amanda was going to take to whiskey. Didn't occur to me. No. All that stuff happens in the course. I knew their natures, and I knew who they would be, and I know that people are unpredictable, difficult, and especially Southern girls. No.
Was there any notion, I mean, I kind of thought about that in Bastard Out of Carolina, the mother takes off and deserts her girls. And was there any consciousness of a mother coming back to pick up her girls?
This is why I think you shouldn't trust writers, because I didn't notice that till I was done. Now, everybody else noticed it. The first thing they said, oh, yes, the mother goes back, just like the mother who left. Oh, I thought, oh, my God, you're right. Felt like a damn fool. Yeah. No, I didn't intend that.
Now, you've spoken really and written very eloquently about why you write.
Yeah.
Would you speak eloquently to us about why you write, besides liking to tell lies?
I'm liable to say something entirely different anytime. I write because I don't know anything else to do. I write because I would write. I would tell stories if I couldn't write. And I write essentially because I'm not happy with the way the world is. And I think that writing, telling a mean story beautifully has the possibility of changing how people think. And that's what I want to do. I don't want people to think about poor white trash the way they were thinking about him when I was a girl. I don't want people to think about little baby dykes in Georgia the way they were thinking about him when I was a baby dyke in South Carolina. I don't want people thinking about rape children the way they thought about him when I was a rape child. You write that story, you invite the reader into that mind, you make them feel what it's like to be that person. They don't come out the same. We do enough of this, we might make the world a little different. A lot different, I'd be happy.
So how did you first start writing? Was there someone who introduced you to books in the first place?
My mother introduced me to books. My mother introduced me to Reader's Digest condensed editions and Mickey Spillane. My mother loved mysteries, which is not actually true. I've figured it out since that she didn't really love mysteries. She loved adventure novels featuring tall, lean, dark men with large guns. My mother had a fetish, and so she read Ross McDonald and Mickey Spillane and, what is it, the Executioner series? Do you know what I'm talking about, those books? They're all very predictable, but she read them in great quantity, and then she would give them to me. I would read them and think, eh, and then I'd trade them in for other books. I fell in love with Modesty Blaise, who was dark, lean, a thief, and carried a big gun, so I have my mama's girl. Just a slight variation. Yeah.
And what about books that actually got you excited about?
Well, when you start out as a kid reading, you don't realize that I didn't believe there would be any books about people like me. And I remember when I started finding books about poor Southerners, about queers. I remember the shock and the joy. And I found terrible books, you know. Because, you know, I was born in 49, so I found all those terrible covered books of lesbians who kill themselves. But then I found James Baldwin, and I found Flannery O'Connor, and I found Tennessee Williams, generally in those cheap paperback editions that I would get in trade for the books my mama gave me. I remember when I got Three by Flannery O'Connor with the cover torn off. And all of a sudden, it was like, fiction wasn't just a world where you went to hide out. Fiction might actually talk about me. And every now and again might say something that I recognize as truthful about people like me, instead of just making me hate myself or be convinced again that the world hated us. I remember when I read Taylor Caldwell, too. Did you ever read Tobacco Road? Don't.
It's an ugly portrait.
It's an ugly portrait.
But you don't write a sympathetic, I mean, you don't write,
I do.
You write a sympathetic portrait, but you don't write, you know, Horatio Alger, poor boy makes good, da 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 da.
That ain't my experience.
That is not your experience.
No, my experience, poor boy marries poor girl, beats the behaves badly. sometimes. Figures out what's going on and behaves a little better. No, I believe in stories in which, you read The Bluest Eye. I remember when I read The Bluest Eye and I read Pecola, and all of a sudden, it was extraordinary. This was a story about a small black child who is held in contempt, who hates herself, who is raped by her father. And all of a sudden, I was reading about me, and I didn't hate her. I was angry at the world for not saving her, and I suddenly had the grace of Toni Morrison's language, and I had this vision of the two little girls who were actually telling you the story, who were friends of Pecola's, and the world looked larger and brighter and wider, and suddenly it seemed to me that things might could be changed. Mm-hmm. So I write terrible stories about people who change. Bastard Out of Carolina is a novel about a young girl who hates herself and who, by the end of the novel, begins to become angry and has, therefore, the possibility of changing and surviving. It's very simple. Cave Dweller is very simple. It's about a woman who is doing herself to death and one day stands up and says, I might not be able to change this, but by God, I'm going to try. I'm writing very simple narratives.
So the writing, how old were you when you actually started writing?
First time I tried to seduce a girl, I was 9. I wrote stories to get people to fall in love with me. Other little girls, teachers, ministers, grown women, I didn't care. I understood that telling stories, especially written stories, especially poems, was a way to get people to look at you and see somebody different, instead of looking at you and seeing just another little white trash piece coming down the road. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden, you become real. And not only that, you become romantic. Especially if you write a story in which you and the little girl you've addressed the story to run off. that's how I started. And then I wrote poems for my mama. Really heartbreaking, wretched poems.
And were there teachers that encouraged you along
the
way?
Yes. Yeah, but I went to school in Greenville, South Carolina. Worst school system in the country, next to Mississippi. Motto of the school system in South Carolina was, thank God for Mississippi. Because clearly they were not going to spend any money or make any changes. So thank God there's somebody worse. We can feel better then. It was a terrible school system. I had one decent teacher in the entire time we lived in South Carolina. But I didn't. My education came from paperback novels. I barely learned to read at school. I hold some people responsible. Yeah.
Let's talk about coming out. You said 9 years old, you already
I knew, yeah. Didn't you?
Took me a while.
Well, acting on it, that's something completely different. I never intended to have sex. Get real. Sex was filthy and dangerous. And you had to admit that you were in love. No, no, no. I just wanted to seduce them, have them fall in love with me and pine for me. I was a Southern girl. I was like very clear about how this worked. And I was an ambitious Southern working class girl whose mama started telling her when she was very young, my mother told me that I was going to college and started saving money. Now, when it actually came to it, we had no money, and all those saving accounts that she put together never had a dime in them. But she told me. So I thought of myself as this person who was going to be different and had to really be serious. And I knew I was a lesbian. And everything that I saw about lesbians told me lesbians become alcoholics, get killed, go crazy, or move to New York City and live very quietly in the village. I was aiming for the latter. I was going to get to college, move quietly to New York City, and find Bebo Brinker. But it's very hard to, it's hard to get to that place when you're from where I started as a kid. No, I never intended to have sex. I intended to be in love. Then hormones happened, and some of that changed, but not for a long time.
So were you out of South Carolina, out of your mama's home when you did first have sex, or is this a forbidden conversation?
I didn't really have what I think of as real sex until I went to college. And there was something about not being in my stepfather's house anymore. For one thing, I got to sleep through the night, didn't have to put nothing against the door. And there were all these girls. Jesus. There was just an entire world of women that were interesting, that read books, that were, like, right, the one I fell in love with, this, my resident advisor, who was a Russian student. She had short clipped hair. She walked around very military. She spoke in Russian. I wanted to have sex with her like nobody's business. And she was very clear that she was straight, and I was completely clear that that could be changed.
And did you change that?
No, but I got the next one, so the next the next resident advisor. But I've, she spoke Chinese. I think for when you come out of a very poor background and you've developed this whole fantasy of life, I think for this is not nice or clean or pretty, but I collected girlfriends with talent. I wanted girlfriends who either spoke Chinese or Russian or were musicians or painted or rode horses. I wanted girls so different from me, they were just like, you know, Audrey Hepburn in the movies, romantic and astonishing. Unfortunately, once you sleep with them, they're not as astonishing as they were. And everything changed.
And did you have to hide who you really were from?
Oh, yes. Yes. I went to college in 1969, 1970. And my freshman year in college, in the middle of the night, some people showed up and hauled out the young woman in the room next to me. Her family showed up with a psychologist. They put her in a straitjacket and took her out of the dorm.
Oh, my God.
And it was patently obvious that the reason they took her out was because she was a lesbian and because she was being very public about it. Her first act, because I remember seeing her do this, they delivered her to freshman dorm, and she took all of the dresses that her mother had packed up and hung in her closet and stuffed them in the garbage in the bathroom and wore nothing but blue jeans and t-shirts, white t-shirts. And I immediately understood, dykes wear white t-shirts. And then very shortly I discovered dykes get taken away in the middle of the night and put in a mental institution, come back a year later after a great many shock therapy treatments. I was very careful. I kept a boyfriend. I had to find a gay man who was willing. But, you know, it wasn't that hard. It was the early 70s. There were lots of gay men who were like, let's be boyfriend and girlfriend, and let's date each other's boyfriends and girlfriends. It was a different world. I think it was the normal world for lots of people that I met in that decade. And it was a world that was just on the cusp of completely changing. Because the year that I graduated from college, that year there were women's liberation meetings on campus at Florida Presbyterian College, where I was attending on scholarship. And I remember going to one of those meetings, standing in the hall outside and thinking, this is dangerous. This is very dangerous to me personally, and not going in because I was a dyke. And there was still women's liberation, dykes. And I was still scared. A year later, I went to women's liberation meetings after I was out of college and nobody could put me in a mental institution. Everything changed.
What happened? What did you get out of that beginning, being in the beginnings of feminism and women's liberation?
A whole new population of girlfriends. Oh, come on. Early women's lib. Why do you think we went to all those meetings? It was, I went to women's liberation meetings, go to consciousness raising, and could be a lesbian. Because you couldn't say dyke. It was, you know, it was 1972, 73. It was still tricky to say dyke. But you could go and you could be a lesbian in public. You could wear commie dyke pins. How many people here have a commie dyke pin? I have my commie dyke pin. It's 30 years old now. I'm very happy with it. The whole world opened up. All of a sudden, I was living in a women's collective, this women's collective. We kept one straight girl just to, you know, just because we didn't want to be prejudiced. But all of a sudden, from living literally in terror that I could be put in a mental institution and given shock therapy for my own good, I moved to Tallahassee, Florida, joined the Women's Collective, moved into a 12-bedroom household with 12 other women, all of whom were having sex with each other. And marching. We were demonstrating for civil rights. We were running the child care center. Me, a dyke, running the child care center, doing rape crisis, doing peer counseling. It was like everybody else was running around being political. It was still the anti-war days, but we were going to change the world at the most basic level. I was very happy.
And do you think we succeeded?
No. However, we've done a lot. My girlfriend is 10 years younger than me. When I first met her, one of our major topics of conversation, aside from the fact that I'm like, I'm not dating you, you're 10 years younger than me, was the fact that she came out into a world in which you could be a lesbian. She never was afraid that she was going to be put in a mental institution. That completely was gone. You know, she lived in San Francisco. She thought this was like normal world. I lived in the South. But that decade, everything had altered. Everything. Nothing is exactly as I would like it. You say feminism now, and people are like, oh, that's so tired. Feminism, as it has been in my life, is a force of revolution. It completely remade things. Listen, I got almost fired for wearing pantsuit to the Social Security Administration. That basic thing. Can you imagine that they would really, you know, fire you and put you on the street because you showed up at work in trousers? No, and all of it had this subtext of queerness. Everything we did that was feminist was in some essential way queer, because to be a woman that was in rebellion against all the rules, wasn't going to marry no boys, wasn't going to make babies for everybody else, wasn't going to have your typical day job and be miserable and drink yourself at night. No, all of a sudden the world changed. I actually threatened to file legal action against the director of the Social Security Administration, who told me that they could fire me for wearing pantsuit, and I told him he couldn't. I wouldn't have known I could say that if I hadn't been going to the Women's Center all the time. No. And he would have gotten away with it, by the way. 1975. He could have fired me and gotten away with it. The whole world is different. You can wear multiple piercings in your eyebrows and they can't fire you now. It's yes, the world is different. Yes, it's still dangerous to be a lesbian. Yes, it's still dangerous to be a feminist. No, there is not justice, but there's a hell of a lot more possibility for justice. Yeah.
So I had read somewhere in Skin that while you were working for the Social Security Administration, you began writing letters that turned you into the writer that you are today.
Yeah, writing letters to girlfriends that I never mailed. Yeah. On some basic level, writing is about explaining the world to yourself. And the letter form was a way that I started. And sometimes just trying to explain my family to myself and to my girlfriends. Because I tended to date, you remember that thing about women with talent? They tend to be middle class. Trying to explain working class families to middle and upper class girls is a lot of how I started writing fiction. Trying to make my people, my family, my neighbors real, but not frightening and not caricatures. That's very complicated. Yeah, that's how it started. That and the desire to write really good country western music. And
I wanted to ask you about music, because Bone in Bastard Out of Carolina is in love with gospel music.
Yeah.
Do you use music in your writing?
Sure. Yeah. But I'm a child of rock and roll. Mm-hmm. I'm much closer to Delia than Bone. I deliberately gave Bone all my mother's music. Some of it I did because my mother was alive when I started working on the novel. And because she loved great, my mother had fine taste in gospel. She loved the Carter family and all of those old amazing songs. And she had a very small collection, but she had Ruth Brown. Do you know Ruth Brown?
Who was here.
Yeah. But Ruth Brown's early songs, Mama, He Treats Your Daughter Mean, And she had that Boiler House way of singing, "Mama, treat your daughter mean," and that stuff. That's gospel on some basic level, that kind of gospel. So the entire book I built around my mother's music. At the very end of the book, you get one reference to Elvis Presley, and then it shifts into Patsy Cline. It was also my mother's music. It's Patsy Cline and I forget the other singer that I use at the very end of the book. But that's the music that I played while writing the book, because I think a lot of timing and meter is unconscious when it's done, when it's at its best. So I play the music to get the timing and meter in my head, but I play the same stuff over and over and over again. That tends to make you phase out. You don't hear the words after a while, you just hear the music. I make tape loops and play them when I'm working. And generally, different characters will have different tape loops.
Huh.
It's pretty deliberate.
Huh.
Yeah. Drives everybody else crazy. How many times can you listen to Walking After Midnight? I can listen to it for years, but my girlfriend lost her patience.
Now, you got in trouble with your community itself when your sexuality turned out not to be plain vanilla?
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of different communities within the women's movement, within the lesbian community, within the feminist community. I always believed, and I still believe, that feminism was about insisting on an essential integrity of sexual desire for women. Within that, I thought, all sexual desire. Honey, look at me. I'm Southern white trash femme. There is only one sexual object for me. It's kind of a female James Dean. But imagine James Dean drunk and really pissed off. That's my object of choice, or it's not even a choice. It's just, you know, a really dangerous, dark-eyed woman comes in the room and every little hair on my body goes, ooh. Really sweet, good-natured girls come in, smile at me, be nice to me, nothing. No. So aside from leather, S&M, any kind of sexual experimentation, I like rough trade. At least the semblance of rough trade. Because, you know, when you get right down to it, most of the time it's more about the semblance than the reality. And I was always trying to construct a life without a kind of a fearless life, a life without hidden sources of danger, which meant to me I had to be very matter-of-fact about the nature of my desire, the way I had to be matter-of-fact about being an incest survivor. Because any time that I started trying to hide or pretend or be careful, I started wanting to die and being very frightened and ashamed of myself. Shame for me is very dangerous. So my version of feminism was about an adamant matter-of-factness about sexuality. Well, honey, in any period in history, this is going to get complicated. But in the 70s and early 80s, it got intensely complicated, because a sector of the women's movement became stringently anti-pornography and subsumed a lot of lesbian sexual desire under that rubric, so that butch femme became unspeakable. Leather sex, oh honey, you might as well just give it up and stop doing that at all. There was also this concept of after the revolution, which I actually had someone say this to me. It's like, yes, I understand that you have this kind of twisted nature to your sexuality, and I'm sure that it's a product of your terrible upbringing. But I think we have to wait and deal with that after the revolution. Someone actually told me. It's like, you can have orgasms after the revolution. It's like, when were you scheduling the revolution? Like, maybe I could hang on for a day or two, but if we're talking decades and millennium, it ain't happening. It's absurd, but I still think it's absurd. At the time, however, people were intensely serious about it. So yes, I did get into a certain amount of difficulty.
But I think that's interesting what you were saying about the importance of telling the truth for you.
And being somewhat realistic about people's real lives. Because I used to date some of the very girls that were talking bad about me in public. They were dangerous. What can I tell you?
So how has motherhood affected you?
Got in the way of sex, rather considerable. Yes, yes. I tell people that my son is easily two books and I won't be able to write because he's that demanding. He's also a hell of a lot of orgasms Mama just didn't have. Everything alters. Everything alters. One, you give up sleep and sex for at least a year, sometimes two. In our case, we squeezed it, but still. Yeah, I know. And then things happen that I hadn't expected or understood. The whole world looks different. I suddenly have to think about school systems. Now, a lot of how I have thought about myself in the world has always been that I am intensely, I identify strongly with my sisters and their children. So I've always worried about school, especially for working class kids. And I have always worried about health care. But now I have a child. Now I want to grab the world and kick its ass. You have no right requiring me to raise a child in which there is not an easy, accessible, good, uniformly good education system for everybody. And I'm very serious about this. Now, I've thought these things before, but Wolf has put me into overdrive. Mm. My child, you know, this little boy that I had to deal with the St. Luke's Hospital people with rather seriously. And all of a sudden, I have to do basic feminist education for people who don't see it coming. Because I show up, and I dress nice when I go out with my boy. I show up with this six-year-old, and people say things. And all of a sudden, I'm doing feminism 101. Yes, he's my son, my partner, Alex. My female lover is his mother. And then we have to do that whole thing. And my son is being very patient. All of a sudden, you have to become an advocate for normal lesbian family life. I don't use the word normal easily. And I have trouble with this whole family values thing. But all of a sudden, I'm a paragon of family values. We're an alternative family values family, but what the hell? It gets very complicated. Because also, I have a six-year-old who gets embarrassed easily. Mom! You know, it's really great when he couldn't talk. I have to do all this stuff and pay attention to all this stuff. It would be so easy just to be the lesbian artist and flirt with dangerous women. And now I gotta go do childcare and talk to the PTA. Jesus, God. And it is all very, very boring and very, very basic and very necessary. Yes, and I'm no longer as sexually interesting as I used to be, I can tell. You show up and you flirt with the dark-haired, dangerous woman and she says, and you got a kid? It's all over. I'm trying to change that.
Well, you're talking about the importance of education now that you're a mom.
Yeah.
And the importance of libraries must be in there too.
Huge. My boy loves this library. Have you guys been up to the children's library section here? He thinks this is just too cool. He thinks they need more computers because he has to wait in line and he has his mama's patience. But, you know, one of the things, the huge disappointments of growing up in a state where the schools are so bad is that the libraries are worse. I mean, I think part of why I had to become a writer was the books I read in South Carolina's libraries. One thing, they seem to want to write books about colonels. And amazing to me how many military men became the subject of novels you'd find in libraries in South Carolina. And then when I moved to Florida, much better libraries in Florida. We moved to Florida when I was 13. Much better libraries. They had paperbacks, which meant that they had books that were published within the last decade, which is really important for a good library. Then I moved to New York City. And I discovered that you could do research in libraries. And that was, all of a sudden, the world opened to a whole degree that I hadn't imagined. Living in the South and going to the kinds of libraries you find in the South, the great thing about them is you find other readers. It's like going to really good bookstores. But you find other readers who don't have money to buy books, which is me and my people. I'm there. in working in New York, all of a sudden I discovered scholars using the library. And all of a sudden, have you ever been to the reading room in the New York Public Library? It's like a temple. And I suddenly felt like I am in my place. This is my place. When I came here and there's all that light pouring in, it's like, this is another one. This is my place. But doesn't the light hurt the books? I worry about things like that. When I was a kid, I wanted to grow up and be safe, be able to be matter of fact in who I was, and be able to read anything. Libraries are the place where that happens. It's why I give books to the library. I'm a judge for the National Book Awards this year. One of the things that happens when you do that is that you agree to accept 300 books that come to your house. And then I can't have any more books in my house. I can't afford any more shelves. They're full. So I call the branch library in Bernal Heights, and I said, I'm going to get a lot of books this summer. Would you like them? And they're like, yes. What kind of books, she said. Novels. Yes. I like that.
I think it's time for us to open up to this sea of smiling faces and see who would like to ask a question. What we're going to do is the beautiful Miss Daphne, wherever she is going to bring a microphone around.
Hi, what a pleasure. You said that one of your goals in writing Cave Dweller was to prove you weren't a dancing dog. Mm-hmm. What's a dancing dog, and what were you at to prove?
I used to work at a magazine called Conditions in Brooklyn, and Cheryl Clark and Jewel Gomez and I were editors on the magazine. And Cheryl did a conversation with four other black women writers, and this concept came up of the dancing dog. It's not that you dance well, it's that you dance at all. And in terms of black women writers, it was about, you know, they don't even believe we can write, much less that we can write well. And that's pretty much how I feel as a lesbian working class writer. It wasn't that I was good, it was that, look, the dog is doing something. No. So one has a tendency to want to prove that one can do more than just be a phenomenon. It's kind of humiliating sometimes being a phenomenon. A whole new audience to flirt with.
And one thing about the New York Public Library's reading room is that that was the first public room in the United States to have electric light, and the aim of that was that so workers could come and read work.
And it was open late,
right,
with those little cool lights, green shades.
It's wonderful. I have like two questions. When you go on, you discuss the nature of forgiveness, which I thought was very interesting for, say, you know, we're in the same age group, and how easy it has been for cynicism and brutality to rule in novel writing. And in this passage you read, I mean, you're describing a town that's being brutal to a woman. My first thought was The Scarlet Letter, and how you are writing a novel that, unfortunately, I haven't read it, but you seem to be opposing a theme in American literature of brutality toward the rebel, the wounded one. And if you would like to talk about that topic.
I think that, all right, I'm going to be California for a second. I actually think that the essential person who has to be forgiven is the self. You have to forgive yourself. But then, living in the real world, you really do need to seek forgiveness in your community, how you define your community. So I deliberately sent Delia Bird back to Cairo, Georgia, a small town that really holds her in contempt. And it's a very Christian Baptist small town. So there are a lot of very traditional Baptist attitudes toward women like Delia, who also has an illegitimate child. There will probably always be an illegitimate child in every book I ever write. I don't think that the things that they're withholding forgiveness for are the things that Delia is really seeking forgiveness for. So that section of the book is more about how small town life works and how resentment, jealousy, fear, and shame works. No, I wanted to write out how you forgive yourself. And I think it's a slow process. And I think I'm going to be really tacky. You do good works. You work it. You take care of your kids. You are responsible in your community. You're real in the world and matter of fact about your stuff. It's a long book. That's pretty much what Delia does. She does some things that, as a feminist, I don't approve of. She doesn't let herself be in a real relationship because she's putting everything into raising her three girls. And as a feminist, I'm appalled that I wrote that. But it did seem to me to be what Delia would do, what the character would choose to do, being who she is. And she pretty much, she's a very gifted, talented, extraordinary woman who buries herself in a small town deliberately because she wants to give her girls a family, the kind of family she didn't have. She does a great job of it. Now, in the way of the world, I'm not sure that mothers get a lot of thank yous and appreciation. In fact, I'm pretty clear they don't. So in the way of the world, I have to write a novel in which a woman doesn't need a lot of public demonstration of success, that in fact her success is looking at her girls and knowing they're okay. It's a bit complicated. But next time I'm going to write big and flashy and kill somebody. Yeah. This young man with his hand up. Doing that great things with his glasses.
Young man, not really. First of all, I'm really thrilled, ma'am, to be here, and it's an honor. It's almost like seeing Albert Einstein, I think. You know, in one of his emotional sides. You were a genius to write this book, and I actually brought two copies for myself and my best friend, Steve, who plays Jeopardy with me, to be, autographed. But I have actually three things that I wanted to point out. First of all, my name is Larry Pasqua, and I'm trembling as I say this, but one of your ventures was to collaborate with a lot of movie stars to do the movie itself. Did you feel that they did a good justice about it? And what was your experience working with the big, Hollywood buffs as they translated how you really felt about the movie? Yeah. And before you answer that, by the way, this was one of our requested reading for the class of 97 of South San Francisco High School. So this was, really a great deal, and I wanted to give credit to my teacher, Miss Amin, who that was her last year of teaching in our school, and she sent a lot of people to Harvard University and Cornell just because of this book, and we thank you for that.
You're a sweetheart.
And you also brought my friend here, who's an artist.
So I'm raising my boy to say yes, ma'am. Every occasionally no, ma'am, but mostly yes, ma'am. God. Movies. I had very little to do with the movie. I did go to lunch at Angelica Houston's house. She sent a car. And as I've said before, she's a very persuasive woman. She did a really, it's a good movie, and it's a great piece of work. It's extremely useful. I was telling people I was in, was I Albuquerque? I was in some town in the Southwest. I was a little fuzzy on it because I was very tired. And I met some people from the medical school who told me that one of the teachers there require young doctors in training to read Bastard Out of Carolina and to see the movie because she felt that the movie shows them something they don't have a good imagination for. And I think that's real. I think that Angelica Houston brought to the screen something that had not been brought to the screen before. When you see the man who plays Daddy Glenn in that movie pick up Jenna Malone and by the neck and shake her, you see something that a lot of us have experienced, but nobody's ever seen it that way. It's enormously powerful. It really works at making an audience highly motivated and extremely emotional. All that is terrific. And as a novelist, she just about drove me crazy. Because three quarters of the book isn't in the movie. And there's some very deliberate things that I did in the book that are missing in the movie that make it really hard for me. I wanted to show how a young girl develops the kind of capacity for survival that Bone develops. A lot of that is about the kinds of stories that her family tells her, the kind of a sense of humor that the family brings to tragedy. That's not in the movie. And that, so it's very hard. And then, of course, there's Raylene, who becomes, you know, she wears overalls in the movie, and she looks good, but there's no explicit recognition of the fact that she's a lesbian, and that, in fact, she's going to raise Bone when the movie ends. So that makes it very complicated. Given all my petty complaints, I still like Angelica Houston. But this was way small time for movies. This was a $4 million movie. As they have explained to me in great detail, this is nothing, child. It ain't a real big time. I'm waiting to see what that's like. I suspect they'll make a really bad movie. So that is God, she moves good, doesn't she? If you have to carry a microphone, you better move good.
Okay, Dorothy, my name is Kathy, and I have a couple of really big open-ended questions for you.
Okay.
And one is regarding feminism. And I just want to say, I mean, you've probably been asked before, you know, what should feminists do nowadays? And
live as long as possible.
That's okay. But I think all feminists, and especially in this area of the country, are doing a lot of things right and are doing a lot of good things in the community. I would like to see a little more cohesion and communication, but I'm just wondering if you can comment on that. And also, I have a 7-year-old son. Oh. I'm wondering what your comments are on being a lesbian and raising a son.
Boy, two biggies. On raising a son, I got my son in a karate class. It was one of the things I did as a lesbian feminist raising a 6-year-old. I got him into karate last fall. I did it very deliberately. One reason was because he got beaten up in childcare. I ain't never gonna let that happen again. But also I want him to, in a strange way, karate for me was spiritual and taught me something about gentleness, and I wanted my boy to learn that. So yeah, as a mother of a 6-year-old, lesbian feminist, I put him in karate. I think feminism is generational, but I think all political activism is generational. And I actually think that it kind of breaks out naturally, and I think that's a great thing. I don't date very, very young girls no more, so they're going to have to do it on their own. I think that the issues, I know, you'll figure it out, it'll get to. I think that the issues that are important to each decade or each generation are distinct. So I'm quite clear, I mean, I barely go on the internet, really. It's just, it gives me a headache. I do have like a wire, I go on and check AP. When I discovered that I could read the news and didn't have to read the paper, that was a big deal. But other than that, I'm not into online activism. But I know a lot of young feminists who are, and who are doing zines online, and are doing news groups online. And this is a whole area that I am barely competent in. And this is a good thing. No, I think that as a political person, as a politically active person, mostly you have to pay attention, take a deep breath, and think before you act and speak, which is hard for writers, because you know how a damn silly thing it is? You go places and people are like, and what would you say to Bill Clinton if you had him here now? And I'm like, what do I know? I think the man's a cad. What do I care? You know, he voted against welfare. I don't care who he sleeps with. You know, writers don't know more than people on the bus. We just tell stories good. I know more as a politically active feminist than I know as a writer. But I can't always put that in novels. And I'm not always competent to talk about it in public. If you have some ideas about things that people should be doing as feminists, you should tell me. And I'll tell them in New York in the morning.
Yeah. We're going to do 2 more questions.
Yeah. But he did such a great paint job, don't you think?
Hi, I'm Alder, and thank you very much.
Alder.
Let's see. First of all, I wanted to say that I did see you in a documentary last week here at the library, and it just brought so much back to me. We're about the same age. I was born in 48, and it was brilliantly done.
Which documentary was it?
I don't know. I can't.
After Stonewall. Oh, it's premiered?
Well, it was supposed to be when Paris was a woman. And yeah. So
I haven't seen this.
Oh, it was brilliant.
Did I say anything reasonable? Because I haven't seen this.
Well, you probably did, but I have a horrible memory. Okay. You know, it's that age. But anyway, I want to say I have a son, and I am a lesbian, and he's 24. And I had him when I was...
He must be getting sleep and sex again.
Oh, yes, yes. Not yet, but eventually. I had to step back a few years for some personal stuff I had to work on me. But we had witch hunts when I was in the Army, and that was when I was stationed in Germany with his godmother. And so what we had to do was move off post, I mean, because... There was no way, you know, if you were queer that you could, you know, got busted. And so that's what we had to do to protect ourselves. And he was born at Letterman. And I've always been out with him about who I am. But, you know, it tripped his godmother. I was with her at the time, and she hated, you know, she didn't want me to be out to him. Yeah. You know, she wanted, she couldn't handle it. But I've always been very honest with him. And even taken him to quite a few marches, you know, here in the city and up in Sacramento, you know, with Baffer. And we're very close, very close. And he got embarrassed, you know, when he was 5 and 6. Oh, Mom, you know, he even had to be the flower, the ring bearer at one of the ceremony I had with a woman I was with for 10 years. But, you know, we had the car all decorated in the back, you know, driving down Geary Boulevard out to Sutro Park.
We didn't do it that way, but I understand.
Yeah, so, but anyway, I'm really glad you're here. And
thank you.
Hope to say hi out front, too.
Okay,
thank you.
We got one more question, then we're going to let Dorothy sign books, and 10% of the books will go to, 10% of the sale will go to the library. So.
Good. Oh. More shelves.
Hello, ma'am.
Hi.
My name's Maria. I'm from Greenville, North Carolina.
Oh, baby.
And I'm wondering, do you think you would have become the artist you are today if, to your own personal satisfaction, if you had stayed in the South? And do you ever think about moving back?
I'm not leaving California. I go to visit a lot. I go to teach. I actually might go teach for a semester in Georgia, just because it would make so many people unhappy. That's complicated. When I left Tallahassee, Florida, after somebody came to our house and fired a shotgun in the front door. You forget that this was like, you know, we were lesbian feminist activists. Now, the truth be, the guy was drunk. And it's fortunate that he was so drunk, because otherwise he might have waited till somebody opened the door before he shot, instead of just shooting down the door. And I don't think, he wasn't really aware of the fact that we were feminists, but he was clear we were lesbians, and we were getting some, and he wasn't. That was pretty much when I decided, you know, I think I want to move north, where they don't just have shotguns waiting to shoot you on a regular basis. But more than that, I get guilty about not living in the South. Especially when I go to the South and I go and speak to students or do talking or do the stuff that you do if you're a writer in America in this century. And I go to visit my friend Mab Segrist in North Carolina, who's with the anti-Klan activists, who has her address. They keep publishing her phone number and address on the Klan watch line, which is not what you think. It's the Klan information line. And they say, that dyke in North Carolina, that Mab Segrist, she lives at 201. And then they give her phone number. I go visit Mab, and she's living in North Carolina in this community. She's a lesbian, a writer, an activist. She's got a 9-year-old daughter. She lives in the South. I look at her and I think, I'm living in California, in paradise. And I get guilty. So I go to visit a lot, and I do a lot of activism. But I don't want to raise my boy there. I don't want to raise my boy in South Carolina, where adopting children for gay people is illegal, according to the state legislature. I don't want to raise him near his uncles and cousins, who are rednecks with guns and attitude and racist consciousness, and who might, you know, make him go in directions I don't want him to go because they're so romantic and sexy. You know they are. I don't want to raise him in a place where I'm scared all the time, even though I think I should be there. So, you know, when he's like 24 or 26, I might wind up back in the South. But I love this place. I was real happy to get here. You'd have to really work to persuade me to leave. Mm. And no, I wouldn't be a writer if they hadn't shot down my door and threatened to fire me and scared me to death and made me so mad and so indignant that I had to write a book to explain what that feels like. Mm. Yeah.
I'm going to take one more question from the lady with the stripes.
I didn't realize you had been a judge for the National Book Award.
Just and this year.
It's a great tribute to you and to all of us who have supported you. And I thank you for giving your vote, I assume you might have, to Alice McDermott and Allegra Goodman.
I'm voting for this fall.
Oh, you're coming for
I'm
the next one.
I'm reading everything now.
Well, tell us the process for when you get 300 books. What do you do?
Read them, give them to the library. Make notes. Mm-hmm. The other judges, it's a great panel. I get to be in, every other week I get to talk to Terry McMillan, Charles Johnson, Scott Spencer, and Allegra Goodman. Mm-hmm. These are all like real writers. God knows what we're gonna like. I've already got some books I wanna suggest, but we'll see. Yeah. And I get to meet Oprah Winfrey because she's been invited to the 50th anniversary. Because you know, if you're in publishing these days, you love Oprah. Those of you who were here last week to see Wally, we love Oprah. She got good taste. Yes. Did you have a question? No?
No, I was wondering if you had been involved with Charming Billy. And
I love Charming Billy.
Which I think are beautiful books.
Aren't they great? Yeah. We could talk books. I'll see you outside.
Let's thank Dorothy Allison for being here, and she'll sign books out back.